I've been asked to talk about the changing faces of cybercrime and fraud, and I'm also delighted of the excellent introduction from Chris Skipton, so I'll try to follow on from that, but in a slightly unusual way. What I'd like to do, first of all, is examine the demographics that we live in. Currently, by the end of 2015, there'll be 7.2 billion people in the world, and 4.3 billion people capable of employment. So 60% employment to population ratio. If we examine that further, 1.3 billion people, or 30% of that working force, will routinely work remotely. So keep that in mind. Looking at some other statistics, we have 4.9 billion connected things by the end of this year. So 4.9 billion connected things mean 4.9 billion things that are capable of being accessed and therefore of being compromised. So let's bear that in mind. The digital phenomenon has transformed lives and gives us the ability to affect the world around us, either for good or for bad. As we've said, more and more of us work remotely from anywhere we are, from any device. And by the end of 2025, Generation Y, also known as the millennials, will represent 75% of the workforce. These people will actually drive new workforce behaviors. But what are they? And are we aware of them? Well, let's have a quick look at that. Does that start automatically? Growth in the mobile workforce is a challenge to all of us, but that also means that criminals will be able to phish, spoof, skim, packet sniff, keylog, and impersonate their way into even more sensitive information. In fact, is Generation Y actually Generation Risk? And as you can see from these statistics, the attitudes are very different nowadays for these people that will constitute most of the workforce going forward. So we all know we're fed up with passwords, but they're still here. We've got so many. There are so many statistics on passwords. Average user, 26 password protected accounts, only 5 passwords. 27% of businesses expect their employees to remember 6 or more passwords to access their environment. And 51% of consumers share passwords with friends, family, and colleagues. So that means that because we have more and more online personas, those personas are actually at risk. We access multiple websites, we access multiple applications, either within the infrastructure or in the cloud, within and outside the enterprise. It's no wonder then that 552 million total identities were exposed in 2013. We'll soon have the 2014 figures when the prominent reports will come out in the next couple of months. That's nearly a 500% increase. You've all seen the major data breaches that happened over the last 18 months. Let's have a look at that.
You know, we've been hearing a lot about cybersecurity lately, largely because of what happened to Sony. Companies and individuals are more concerned about the safety and privacy of their information than ever. President Obama has unveiled a number of new proposals this week to crack down on hackers, and he plans to address this in the State of the Union speech on Tuesday. And it's great that the government is working on this, but the truth of the matter is we need to do a better job of protecting ourselves. You know, the most popular password in the United States is password 123. And as long as that's the case, we're vulnerable. So today we sent a camera out on Hollywood Boulevard to help people by asking them to tell us their password. And this is how that went.
We're talking about cybersecurity today and how safe people's passwords are. What is one of your online passwords currently?
It is my dog's name and the year I graduated from high school.
Oh, what kind of dog do you have?
I have a Chihuahua Papillon.
And what's its name?
Jameson.
Jameson. And where'd you go to school?
I went to school back in Greensburg, Pennsylvania.
What school?
Hempfield Area Senior High School.
Oh, when did you graduate?
In 2009.
Oh, great.
It's like my cat's name and then just like a random number.
Okay. But, you had this cat for a while?
Yeah, she's my childhood pet.
Aw. And what's her name?
Her name is Jolie.
Jolie. Mm-hmm. So like a password of yours would be Jolie and then a number.
Yeah.
Like number one?
Like my birthday.
Oh, when is your birthday?
June 12th.
Oh, nice. And what year were you born?
95.
Oh, great. Mm-hmm. So Jolie, 6, 12, 95.
Yes.
Got it.
So you mean to give my password right now? No, I cannot do that.
But we all want to know what it is so we can tell you if it's strong or not.
Oh, my goodness. Let me think. Okay, one is Tel Aviv. Yeah. 4, 6, 8. And then Israel. It's only 3, but it's, you know, it's, for me, it's strong enough.
Ireland, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Gemma, 1, 2, 3. Spelled G-E-M-M-A.
Well, most of them are Italian.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah,
Like, what's a good Italian password?
My grandma's name.
What's your grandma's name?
Maria.
Maria. So Maria is your password?
Oh, yeah, now you know my password. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, the important thing is they learned a terrible lesson. I am just...
So these are the people you employ. They're not bad people, but the reality of it is breaches then with more than 10 million identities exposed grew from 1 in 2012 to 8 in 2013, and that was a 7% increase. So if we examine that a bit further, you can see that the top rank is real name, date of birth, government identification numbers such as driving licenses, home address, medical records, phone numbers, financial information, email addresses, usernames and passwords, and insurance details. All of these have real value to criminals. And the reason why they have real value is because they enable criminals to commit ID theft. In the UK, 60% of all fraud was actually ID theft, according to the CIFAS Fraudscape report of last year. So we'll see the figures this year in April when the new report comes out. But what is interesting to note is that stolen credentials, obviously, is number one, or was number one for last year. Phishing moved from number nine to number three. Phishing attacks are extremely successful and extremely easy and cheap to perform. Okay, and of course, technology, whilst extremely helpful in a business environment, introduces new risk. And therefore, it makes it that new behaviors, new working practices, are actually one of the biggest risks to organizations. And of course, technology evolves constantly. So now we keep hearing about the Internet of Things and wearables and how it affects the industry, and enterprises saying, well, no, I won't have any wearables. And we know they all said that when the mobile devices came on board, and there's obviously no such thing as BYOD. But nevertheless, wearables are here. Wearables are being used. Wearables are about logging even more sensitive information. Wearables are connected to a mobile phone, which may have access to an email address, which may be a corporate email address, which may be the subject of phishing attacks, which may compromise an organization's environment. And essentially, it is set to grow. Everyone knows that the Nest thermostat were hacked, that the Samsung smart TVs were hacked. Digital consumers will buy connected devices, smart devices for their home, and greater connectivity actually brings greater risks. And that market is set to grow, so we cannot ignore it. And because we cannot ignore it, and I'm sure Chris will agree, suddenly we have the UK government pronouncing on data protection in, as far as wearable technology is concerned. And also, the UK government considering proposals to criminalise failure to prevent economic crime. Now, if you look at the NCA definition of economic crime, which I'm sure you're familiar with it, but one very important point that is in there is identity theft. Identity theft is considered economic crime. If those proposals come to pass, that actually means that executives of organization would be liable for identity theft. And of course, the cloud. More and more of the cloud. The cloud is very attractive. It's very attractive because it makes mostly economic sense. It is flexible. The price is adjustable. Desire for mobile working pushed by new behaviors of Generation Y or millennials. And for those in retail, for example, seeking the holy grail of omnichannel means the cloud must be an inherent part of infrastructures. And that brings all sorts of considerations to mind. And again, talking about modern behaviors, they will increase the reliance on the cloud, they will increase the reliance on managed services and other third-party solutions. And that's interesting because that brings us to the supply chain. If we're increasingly putting our trust in third-party providers, how will we actually manage due diligence to stay in control of the vulnerabilities we have, and certainly to stay safe, keep ourselves safe, as well as our customers? I lost my mic here, so if you bear with me, we'll keep it again. There we are. And indeed, as ever, you know, Americans are slightly ahead, but suddenly to satisfy clients, law firms submit to cybersecurity scrutiny. And that's quite interesting. Some insurance companies are starting to use schemes to actually validate any kind of cover they would actually give in terms of cyber liability, and some starting to point out, for example, to cyber essentials, which Chris mentioned earlier on. So is it time for a new approach to security. So with cloud and mobility, the perimeter firewall handles a lot more internal to internal traffic. By 2018, the cloud will represent 76% of total data center traffic. If you overlay that with BYOD and mobile working growth, security risks from within an organization's network are expected to grow by approximately 45% by 2017. So what have we to contend with? Well, any organization has to contend with three things: performance, availability, and security. And there are obstacles, and these obstacles are 52% of businesses are struggling to manage application security in this new world, or application performance and availability, because of disjointed, complex, and hard to manage environments. I'm sure this will resonate with many of you. So are we aware of this? Well, enterprise assets, as I've tried to explain, are no longer within the known perimeter, as we used to know. The perimeter has actually crumbled because there are so many more things that we use, that we connect to. And therefore, that very perimeter has fractured. So how can we actually manage it? Well, let's have a look at this. New working patterns will challenge application access and security, according to this survey by Barracuda Networks and Freeform Dynamics. Most people agree that that is the case. Similarly, poor and unpredictable application performance negatively impact businesses. Most people agree that that is the case. The reverse of the coin, of course, is that do they recognize the need to move from network perimeter to application perimeter? Most of them do. Have they done anything about it? Most of them don't. So do we need a paradigm shift from internal to external versus public to private, from network perimeter to application perimeter? Because, you know, there's a famous phrase that says, there's an app for that. So hyperconnectivity and the growth of the application economy, combined with the lack of business readiness, have facilitated the explosion of cybercrime. I'm sure you will agree. And in terms of attacks, there are two kinds. There are those that are very intentional, and there are those that are opportunistic. Lots of people talk about APTs, which are in the first category. But let's have a look at the type of attacks that organizations can actually be faced with. Well, if they are randomly opportunistic, which, as you can see from the chart at the bottom coming from Verizon, most of the attacks are actually opportunistic because they are easy to perform. Cybercriminals will target any business with weak security practices and with obvious vulnerabilities because it's cheap to do. And the motives is low-hanging fruits, and they will find information that they can actually monetize. And I'm nearly out of time, so I'm going to skim through that. Oops, that was quick, wasn't it? I'd like to go back. Okay. You bear with me, I think my clicker doesn't work anymore. Sorry, John. Okay, so opportunistic attacks, easy to perform. But there's the other kind, which I wanted to show you, which is intentional attacks. So those that will target organizations specifically for a very specific purpose, highly visible, environmental issues, political, celebrities, and motives, it's to further a specific agenda, or even to manipulate markets. So if you look at the JP Morgan hack earlier on, account-level fraud will actually damage accounts. But if you remember the AP, Associated Press Twitter hack a couple of years back, it was actually, it crashed the Dow Jones about 4 points for about a few hours because they actually mentioned that something happened in the White House. But more and more, we start seeing this, trying to manipulate economies and markets. And essentially, organizations are slow to actually discover and recover from attacks. If you look at the chart on the right, it's actually the target share price over 18 months. And it shows on there, it's a bit faint, that it actually took them a year to recover to their original share price pre-breach. Verizon DBIR PCI report shows that people, process, and technology is still not understood. And criminals know your business better than you do. So you're all familiar with the cyber kill chain. The earlier you actually catch a crime, the better. Threat intelligence is absolutely crucial, going back to what Chris was saying earlier on. And they're very adaptable criminals. Any piece of new technology coming on the market will be reverse engineered and exploit kits will actually be sold. So it's about knowing yourself, being vigilant, planning thoroughly to respond quickly, and in fact, managing your risk. So stack the odds in your favor, understand and classify, invest in people, and be prepared.